This week on Maker Update, leaping tall forklifts in a single bound, a canoe 100 years in the making, a perfect three-point sculpture, digital drums, colorful kicks, and how to not set your workshop on fire. Hello and welcome back to Maker Update. I'm Tyler Weingartner and I hope you're all doing great. I've taken a little bit of time off from my workshop to do some traveling, but I'm really excited to get back into a few projects. And I hope you are too. We've got another great show for you to hopefully spark some inspiration. So let's get started with the project of the week. Colin Furze has a real problem with gravity. I guess we all do, more or less, but over his maker career, he's developed a number of projects that take the fight directly to Sir Isaac Newton. And his latest project is another haymaker in that punch-up. This machine is sort of a pivoting swing arm. It's actually quite a lot like that camera jib I talked about several episodes back. The only difference is that instead of a camera as the payload, it's his own body. With some proper counterweights, this should allow him to make superhuman leaps, flips, and jumps with his body weight otherwise supported by the mechanism. Of course, to make everything secure and safe, this mechanism needs to be pretty big. The swing arm itself is around 7 meters long, and the base looks to be around a 3 meter square. The scale alone of this thing makes this build so much fun to watch. He has to lift most of the parts with this oversized forklift just to move it around his shop. There's certainly a good bit of shop envy to be had here, but it's just a joy to see him using his to the fullest. The other surprise is that he didn't go into this with a master CAD design. He's just sort of figuring a lot of this out as he goes along. Of course, he's doing little bits of computer work here and there to plan his next step, and making some really gratuitous use of laser cut templates to check the fit and function of parts before making them out of steel. He finishes up by adding the harness that will secure him to the swing arm and a hydraulic ram that will allow him to extend and retract the end of the arm to fine tune the balance. Of course, the video is a little bit of a tease since you don't get to see him using it other than a few quick tests. That's coming up in a video he hasn't released yet, so keep an eye out for that one. Still, there's a ton of great stuff in this one, from tips to working on all projects, big and small. More projects. Jimmy Diresta has been working on a project that's similarly massive in scale, but on a different axis. Time. He's finally put the finishing touches on the canoe that he's been working on for over a year. But in a way, this boat has been with him for even longer, since most of the wood that's gone into it has been reclaimed from the porch that's been on his house for 100 years. The deck slats were all really tight-grained Douglas fir boards that were still in great shape. Of course, each piece has to be milled down and have the paint removed. His plan was to keep all the cleaner sides of the boards facing outward on the canoe, and anything that showed any stains from finishing or weather would face inwards. Overall, it's a gorgeous project that's consumed a lot of time and shop space over the past year, and the payoff of seeing him out on the water with it is just perfect. JBV Creative has built this beautiful basketball-inspired sculpture for a local museum exhibit. The idea is based around this mechanical arm that repeatedly creates a perfect three-point shot over and over again. You'd think that when he'd nail the mechanism, that's when the hard work is complete. But really, that's just where it begins. Again, this thing has to be a sculpture, so it needs to look good, be repeatable with minimal effort, and he needs to decide which parts are going to be hidden and which are visible. It's a great lesson in how the final 10% of a project can easily be 90% of the work. You can find links to the 3D printable files for you to build your own down in the video's description. And finally, we have an instructable by Bingo Banjo 45 on how to convert traditional acoustic drums into digital drums. And the best part is the conversion is completely reversible. The only hardware is this beam that spans the diameter of the drum body, which gets bolted onto the metal hardware that hold the drum head on. At the center of the beam is a piezo sensor and a foam cone that just barely touches the heavy-duty mesh that replaces the traditional drum head. The leads from the piezo sensor can then be soldered into a 1/4-inch TRS plug, which can be used to interface with an electronic kit's head unit. With a little bit more electronics hacking, I bet you could skip the head unit altogether and roll your own CircuitPython mini controller. Time for some tips and tools. This video is a few weeks old now, but it's such an important lesson in shop safety, it deserves a shout out. Bourbon Moth Woodworking wanted to get to the bottom of the occasional phenomenon, a spontaneous combustion happening in wood shops that can result when you don't properly dispose of oil-soaked rags. He devised this scientific method of testing, using 3 different finishes in 5 different disposal environments. The really insidious thing about this phenomenon is it can take hours for it to happen, easily in the middle of the night after your workday is done. TLDR, let those oily rags dry out on a flat surface before throwing them out. Tim Hunkin has a new video out in his Secret Life of Components series, and it's all about programmable logic controllers, or PLCs. These are a little bit like modern microcontrollers, but they're intended for industrial applications, so they're a lot more robust in their construction and reliability. In the video, he covers how they work, how to program them, and how to find and make use of used PLCs, since they can be a lot more expensive than their microcontroller counterparts. If you're looking to beef up your project, check this one out. Back on Instructables, Cutting Paths has a guide on how to understand and design around your laser cutter's particular kerf to make snap fit parts that require zero gluing. The kerf is the width of your cutting tool and the width of the material that's removed. The kerf of a laser is really tiny, but it's not negligible, especially if you want tight fitting parts. If you have a set of feeler gauges, you can use these to measure your kerf, or you can just do it by trial and error. Once you know it, you can either incorporate it into your designs, or if you use software like Lightburn, you can have it make those offsets automatically. And Becky Stern has a great new video on different methods for creating your own custom shoes from boring plain stock. She goes through a few different techniques: hydro dipping using purpose-made film, hydro dipping with marbled spray paint, and 2 dyeing techniques: stovetop dip dyeing and marble dyeing. She even street tests each of these to see how they hold up in the real world. Personally, I love the look of these two-tone dyed shoes, and it seems like this should hold up to regular wear too. For this week's Digi-Key Spotlight, Shawn Hymel has a video introducing the concept of thread. This is a mysteriously named technology which serves as a standardized networking protocol for various IoT and smart home devices. You'll get to learn how the network stack works, how the network topology gets formed, and what advantage thread has over conventional protocols like Zigbee and Z-Wave. He finishes the video by talking about a few dev boards that use thread, so you can start playing with the protocol on your own. All right, and that is gonna do it for this week's show. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope you found something you liked in it. If you did, tell us about it down in the comments. Maybe give us a thumbs up and hit subscribe so you don't miss the next one. As always, big thanks to Digi-Key for making this show possible and to you for watching. Take care, we'll see you soon.